रमाराज सर, गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग डॉक्टर श्यामलाल।
गुड मॉर्निंग वन एंड ऑल। वेलकम टू डे 7 समर स्कूल ऑन मशीन एंड डीप लर्निंग फॉर रिमोट सेंसिंग एप्लीकेशन। टुडे वी हैव रिसोर्स पर्सन प्रोफेसर रमाराव फ्रॉम IISc त्रिवेंद्रम। ऑलरेडी दिस इज हिज सेकेंड लेक्चर, सो ऑलरेडी यू नो प्रोफेसर रमाराव, so directly we will start the session. I request Professor Amara sir to start your session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you Dr. Samlal, and thank you all the participants for joining. In this particular session there are two things. For some time I would give some outline of some of the works that we have done on this 3D point cloud analysis for remote sensing purpose, and also a bit of demonstration of the same thing. So this contains two of these things, and let us move on that thing. This is all about this LiDAR remote sensing. So we hope, I'm not sure if many of you are familiar with this LiDAR remote sensing. But in effect, if we just like to have very crisp recap of some of these things related to LiDAR remote sensing, it is a cloud of points. So cloud is an apt word for describing this kind of data, wherein there would not be any structure, there would not be any regularity, there would not be any expectation of something would be existing at this point or not. So it could be as random as possible, but at the same time, when you look at these clouds, we can actually decipher some of the structures and shapes as well. So that way, this LiDAR point cloud is one thing which is in essential a random way of describing structure of any object that you can see. So that can be anything, a scene, a building, a tree, or as small as a toy. So based on this kind of things, it is usually called terrain LiDAR remote sensing, and we simply call 3D LiDAR thing. So what in effect contains it is, you can see coordinates X, Y, and Z. So it has got for each and every location. Location is not sampled regularly, okay? So it is little depends upon what happens at each instant of the sampling. So at each and every spatial location, you would have got location X, Y, and elevation. So that elevation has actually multiple things. It's not only the elevation of surface Earth, but elevation of the object that you can see. So elevation includes multiple things, as we can see. And as I mentioned, this point cloud is not regular. Depending upon the kind of scanning pattern, you would find ideally so many kinds of ways of point cloud acquisition. And imagine this is also one of the ways of seeing. So while in theory, it looks like a very organized, and you can find that there is no point here at all. So there's no sampling here if you follow this kind of thing. Here, sampling is done regularly, but in between you may not find. And each of these dots would correspond to an area of what we call a footprint. So it is equivalent to a spatial resolution in a regular raster image. That way, land is our object is sampled at discrete locations, and it in between it is a complete open space, so unsampled part of the object or terrain. And if it densely sampled, you would find lot of the thing. The reason is that in between that area may not be several meters or several tens of meters. That's why you would find still lot of point cloud representing the surface. The major important thing is that, of course, now you can find satellite and even other things are there. But when it started with the terrain application, it's all started with this airborne thing. One thing that makes it is very distinct is that, yeah, as you can see, The point represents very small area. If it is diverging, then you will find that very small portion of subject, I mean, the object is always sampled. That makes sure that object, land surface object, is sampled for multiple points on its surface. So that makes sure that it is not one unit for the object, but multiple units of representation for each object. That way, you get a dense cloud of points representing each of the objects in which the scanning is happened. And of course, it's not necessary that you will get dense scan. There are so many parameters which describe the nature. And the distinct nature of this one is that it's a pulse thing. There are two ways. So pulse can actually pass through the any kind of gaps in the object. So imagine a tree usually represented with a continuous spatial pixel in a raster image. Whereas if it is a point cloud, even the gaps in the canopy can be sufficient to allow the laser scan to pass through the canopy and hit the ground and have the difference of a height between the canopy and ground measured as the response of the distance. That is the advantage of using this laser data particularly for some of these very terrain applications. This is how this penetration happens. So you may find a lot of differences. So at this moment, we will be concentrating on how do we have some sort of applications developed for this TLS or with a 3D point cloud. We started all with about 7 to 8 years back, I think about 2013. We started off researching on this LiDAR point cloud with objective of little bigger area in the sense in an urban kind of application. For example, it can be three-dimensional modeling of buildings, roads, cars, trees, everything that you can find in urban scene, thought of 3D modeling using this kind of urban kind of thing. So while this point cloud look like very organized here, but actually each of the points is an independent point. So it all looks like, you know, how you connect the dots. So the way you connect the dots defines the thing that you are going to get at the end. So all that connection of the dots is about the entire processing of your LiDAR point cloud. So how do we deploy these kind of algorithms which would connect the dots, organize them, and finally make the dots connected to a line, and if the lines are interdimensional, going to be objects. Okay, three-dimensional objects. So as you can see, we managed this kind of starting off with 3D point cloud segmentation, wherein both aerial imagery and point clouds are considered for segmentation, and finally some sort of organization. So if you compare point cloud and multispectral image, it something looks like something like this. So for example, on the left side is multispectral image, high resolution multispectral image is corresponding to ship harbor. Okay, and the right side refers to LiDAR point cloud. It's very dense point cloud, about 60 points per meter square. So how to analyze and process this point cloud such that you can get an overview or three-dimensional view of this entire scene that you can see in the multispectral image is the necessary processing that usually done. So there are two or three different ways of doing that. The first thing that you can think of is that segmentation. So we are familiar with the segmentation of images and segmentation of even some of these DEMs or other elevation data as a two-dimensional raster image. But if you truly like to exploit the capability of 3D point cloud, this has to be done in a three-dimensional view. So this is one of the 3D segmentations done. And then the next step is actually, once you segment it, then the next point goes to the classification. So you classified it, and the classification, you know, the difference is not something like we always used to say segmentation as object and aggregate. But the key difference here is that objects are segmented, but they are not been fully connected like a regular surface. So they are still in the 3D, and once you classify them, the segments are now labeled, and this labeling is again at a point level. So you still find that the scope or features of these points are always in the it's a primitive level, I would say final level. So if you classify and then further, you can actually make a three-dimensional view of those scene, as you can see here, something like that. And then once you get this kind of classified three-dimensional point cloud, then perhaps using such a kind of modules or softwares or algorithms where you can reconstruct objects using surface SolidWorks. For example, we did some of the things, example like this, and finally you can actually build a solid model out of this kind of thing. So these are all the things that you expect a part of any 3D point cloud model using LiDAR data. And the crux is that what is the kind of parameters data that correspond to, and what you want actual ultimate. Here in this particular case, our aim is to three-dimensional model it. So classification and 3D modeling it, and finally preparing a 3D metric, true metric, three-dimensional objects of an urban scene. It can be anything. So the same thing can be extended to other cases, whereby you can employ this 3D point cloud not only for mapping, but even for measurement and prediction purposes as well. So that is what the primary aim of this particular thing. And so if you look at it, if you look the way this technology is changing is remote sensing, particularly the remote sensing technology application in precision agriculture, or we'll say agriculture for that matter. It has vital role in terms of area, crop type, and also advisory services on the incidence of pest or expected. Such kind of things have been very well exploited in remote sensing context. But what actually farmer needs is different from what government needs about the farming. So these two things are not one and same. The very same remote sensing technology can be quite different when you look from the farmer perspective and when you look from the policy maker or let's say government perspective. If you go with that, let us say estimation of yield may be very much interested to both government and let's say farmer. But the most important factor a farmer would like to know about his field is that what is the already available nutrient in a particular patch of his agriculture field. So his agriculture field may not be several hundreds of hectares. So a small field of 1 acre or maybe a couple of hectares of land at most. So if you like to benefit from the technology application in agriculture, you should be knowing some of these parameters for him in a much more amenable form, such that he can optimize his resources and take advantage of contributing to the environmental protection, as well as optimizing the yield and optimizing the expenditure involved in this one. So one of the two factors that make is that agriculture involves two things. One is the mapping. So that is, let's say, classification or discrimination, all that comes into a category of mapping. The other one is the prediction of parameters. For example, prediction of nutrient, prediction of yield, prediction of disease type, or prediction of some plant parameter. These are all biophysical estimations. So other one is the what kind of crop it is. Particularly when you like to know a little more automation of the farming, the first thing comes is to identify what is this plant. And unfortunately, in this reflectance-dominated remote sensing, we always have these two problems. Sometimes agriculture crops, two different crops may look very similar by spectrally. If you take a spectrum, even very high resolution spectrum, they look almost similar with the same kind of inflections and troughs that is the same wavelength. So that makes sure that the spectral remote sensing, that's what we call either multispectral or hyperspectral, any kind of optical remote sensing, fails to give a kind of discrimination. Because the difference of the plants or crops is not by, let's say, physical things, but visual geometrical things. So they may be varied only by height and a little more horizontal as a vertical expansion. So their optical spectra may not be helpful. Similarly, you get another case where they look same. Two different crops may look very similar, but they're actually different crops, such as, let's say, rice and wheat. They may look structurally similar, but spectrally quite different. So that makes sure that you have two problems, where in some cases, the spectral attributes are still the dominant determiners, and in some cases, it is the geometry, structure or geometry, that plays the role of the discriminator. So when you like to have those kind of scenarios, this is a big problem. And particularly another thing that is very important in agriculture is this prediction of structural parameters. So if you look practical application of agriculture in remote sensing, what is required is not an entire field or let's say taluka district level, but in fact within a field and a patch level. So please just hold on a second. For example, one of the applications is that, imagine if you like to predict the crop height. So you know what is the plant height today, and you like to know what will be the most probable height of your crop after say 15 days. And if that is known to you, perhaps you can optimize some of the parameters, whether to apply nutrients or not, or whether to plan harvesting or not, or whether to know that crop is growing as its structure or as per its needs, like that. So you can have lot of information that agronomic importance, particularly at the farmer level. So based on understanding what is done today, if you like to have a tool, a technique which enables you to estimate what is going to be the next state of a crop during its crop growth cycle is another important thing. So if you like some of the things, that's what you measure today, some parameter, maybe height, you measured another date, and if you like to know what is parameter going to be on some day. So if that is the case, you are going to have some sort of combination of data and techniques which are discriminating as well as predicting. So in that context, you have got a vital application of this 3D point cloud in remote in agriculture. So if you just give a brief categorization of the remote sensing technical application, particularly in agriculture, I mentioned that it is a measurement, prediction, so either get structural parameters or biophysical parameters, so nutrients, height or canopy area, and even health information such as the stress or the occurrence of a kind of disease, are all comes under this biophysical prediction. And then identification, what kind of crop it is, and the discrimination between crops, and the crop versus wheat, crop versus soil, then some bare soil mean background. So these are all different kind of things that you can always find. And what actually the most important that comes is the scale at which you actually look at. That is another parameter which determines what kind of thing you are going to get. So level varies from field to a small field to region level or even national level, and scale varies from a plant to field or even much higher. So it is the combination of these parameters which define what kind of sophistication is required for applying remote sensing in agriculture. So So that's why you have got a combination of technologies. Let's say multispectral, all this kind of thing. So it indicates that not a single kind of mode, single kind of technology fully. So you need to think of deploying multiple kind of combinations and at different scales, such that you derive the information and data needs. It is at the level, at the scale at which farmers can take actionable initiatives. So that is the kind of requirement. So in this particular, in the remainder, I will just like to share with you all some two different studies, which are again this three-dimensional LiDAR remote application for agriculture. And we use it particularly a ground-based laser scanner to scan the point cloud, the sensor field, and how we use this kind of point cloud for deriving some of these precision agriculture-related parameters is what we like to share with you. And a bit of it, we can have a demo also. So this I already made there. If you look at this, what happens is that the application of LiDAR is very, very diverse. So if the object happen to be crop, then even you can have a crop identified by its geometry. So based on its height and other kind of structural parameters, which you can discriminate from this 3D point cloud, you can actually map a crop. And if the crop is some small object, if you go to a large extent and say that my plant is now a tree and the environment is not agriculture but forestry, then you have got the same application in the forest management, so forestry and urban infrastructure. So many kind of applications are there as far as LiDAR is concerned. So as knowing that these remote sensing techniques and the demands for very precision level application agriculture requires information at plant and patch level, we just made few attempts to identify some of the parameters which can be estimated from this plant level. So it is, if you like to state it, this is the way that we can state what is the problem statement that we have with us. And for this, these data are actually our proprietary data at which we set up an exclusive experimental setup in Bangalore. And different crops are grown. So for example, three different crops are grown: tomato, cabbage, and brinjal, at different kinds of nitrogen levels. And different replications have also been there. This is the satellite, world view satellite picture. Of the left side is the world view satellite picture. And And the right side is the experimental setup. And we grow crops with different kinds of nutrient status. Idea is, can we able to discriminate these crops at a very finer level and also specific to nutrient level? So that is the question that we have. And these are some of the experimental setups which we used it. So both ground level hyperspectral, ground level laser scanning, and drone-based hyperspectral imaging were also done, but that we have not used in this particular study, that used in different context. So that is one thing. And these are the some of the experimental photographs that we captured while the different crops are there and the different periods of growth. So this picture is something like where this LiDAR point cloud is being taken. So if you just have one scan of a LiDAR, it looks something like this. This is a typical appearance of visualization of a LiDAR point cloud. So we will be always taking this data in a time series, and particularly when you like to have entire crop growth cycle represented, so it's always a kind of time series thing. And these were registered and all that filtering, etc. were done. So, yes. So finally, what you can have something like this kind of outcome, in the sense that each data measurement, you can have this plant layer, where the individual plants are represented as an amalgamation of points. So these are all having each and every point has an association with your plant. This is part of your plant, and there is XYZ coordinate for each and every point. So based on this, you can actually estimate few things, classification or parameter estimation. So if you like to have several structure parameter estimated, then the kind of algorithms that you deploy on this basic process level would be the input. So this is the sequence of the things. So what we did is that for all the days, you will have a rasterization representation so that field level normalization is done, such that the height is height base height is each and for every day, and plant is day. So of course segmentation, and from that you are able to do things. For example, in this case, so then once we get segmentation, then from that the crown area, because apart from height, crown area is an important parameter. That is a parameter which defines and discriminates different plants. For example, tomato versus brinjal, brinjal versus let's say chili. So those are the things which actually reflect in the crown area, not mainly in the height, because by height many things can be confused. So once you get, then you will have to have some parameter estimated, and then use certain kind of models. For example, in this case where we try to estimate the biomass, okay, fresh biomass, nothing but total weight of the plant from this point cloud, based on this support vector regression method. Yeah, you can, yes. So this is just an outline of the overall methodology that we followed. So same thing what we made it. So as you can see, if you see this, every plant crown is now here. So this is a plant crown from which you can have this crown area or any attribute of a plant from this final ready to analyze data product from this LiDAR point cloud. So we just made as a estimation of plant level height with both this DLS and compared with the ground truth measurement. If you can see the correlation between estimated and measured as a function of different levels of nitrogen, let's say low, medium and high nitrogen, you can find that the one-to-one correlation is very, very strong. In fact, almost 0.99 or 0.98%. So, and it's reflected across the crops. And this is one of the parameters, I think, very vital for finding out further usage of the height in many other parameter estimation. And it shows that this TLS or laser has something which can be very distinctly estimated with very high precision and accuracy. And you can find in the next slide the crown area and biomass also. As you can see, if you like to see how this height varies as a function of time, you can see that this is a plot which indicates how the change relationship between estimated and prediction changes over a time. If there is no change, if the dynamics of this estimated predicts are really static, that means the relation between estimated and predicted would not be changing by time, then you will get all the point cloud or the point distributed along the horizontal line. If you find that this is the points are distributed on top of the line, then that indicates a sort of overestimation. If the points are distributed under the line, then they indicate actually underestimation. So as you can see, the relationship is very complex. For tomato, you would find that most of this case, they are lower level, and you would find some places is overestimated and some places it is underestimated. And you would also find something, particularly for the case of eggplant, there is something that is very distinct. If you look at it in the initial days of crop, it is mostly underestimation, but as the crop grows and things, the error is mainly in the overestimation. So you would find that the estimated values are substantially higher, or would say higher only, not the lower. But when it comes to this cabbage, the relationship is little complex. In the initial case, it is non-responsive. When the crop reaches the mid, you will find that most of them are underestimated. And as the crop reaches its full growth, you will find that the estimated height and everything is actually mostly overestimated. So this also important to know that at which stage a particular device is useful and what kind of values that you can get, whether measurements are overestimations or underestimation. And more or less, you would find the relationship is same for tomato. For eggplant, the crown area is something which is very distinct. The second line of second row results, if you see, that is the crown area. You find that that is very systematic. So you find at places underestimation and overestimation. So finally, you will be believing that the error is something very unpredictable in the crop growth. So which requires you to use entire data multiple times. And once you use this kind of parameter, height and crown area, for retrieving further biomass, which is based on this SVR modeling, you can see that despite changes of temporal changes of these height and crown area, if you like to model them for further usage, the derived parameter biomass is very stable. And shows that across the growth stage, you find that the estimated and measured are very closer. And compared to the randomness observed at individual parameter, the biomass is one thing which is very systematic. As you can see in the second row of the figures, most of the times there is not much underestimation or overestimation, and the relationship is very, very stable across different things. So it shows that at individual feature level, or is a individual structural attribute level, you will find that lot of dynamics are there. But if you actually combine them for estimating any other kind of derived parameters, the derived parameters are much more stable, and which is one thing, an important observation when we like to use this kind of LiDAR point cloud of techniques for remote sensing of crops. And these are further things, how these parameters vary as a function of nitrogen and like that. We find that sometimes high nitrogen, low nitrogen is very straightforward to detect from TLS in this point cloud. But when the case of this medium, you would find that the values of these height and the crown area, for example, if you look at, they are somewhere overlapping with the similar parameters for the plants with even low nitrogen or high nitrogen. So always there is some sort of overlapping and fluidity expected with the case of medium nitrogen treatment. So some plants grow as healthy as high nitrogen treated plants, and some will be suffering as if they are given very low nitrogen. And of course, there are some other management and weather factors also contribute to this kind of blurring of boundaries of the nitrogen at the medium level. And so that is, if that is about using traditional machine learning applications for deriving parameters of at a plant level, another thing is also important is to classify these crops, particularly a three-dimensional plant classification, which should look like as if it is standing plant. So for this, we have adapted one of these, and this is not very recent or very old, a point net architecture of the deep CNN, which we further adapted and modified to, you know, apply for this crop classification at plant level. And we can directly give the point cloud as input, and the classification is done at object level. So this object level is actually a functional object, not something like image object or data object, but object is actually plant object. Okay. So this is overall methodological flow, which included the pre-processing stage up to this first half is all this pre-processing stage, acquiring and registering, then let us say separating ground versus non-ground. And then from there, you have got to find segmentations, then all this training data, testing data sets, and model selection and training, and finally validation. This is what the overall process for. And we can also have an overview of the network architecture that we use. So this is accuracy metrics, that's common. So this is architecture that we have used for this kind of thing. So the point net architecture, which is I think a 2017 development, is slightly modified to to work for this prop point cloud and to give plant level predictions. Particular prediction is of the label, okay, not the spectral or structural attribute, and finally to have a semantic level classification of points. So once you give all this output, filtered and non-filtered, and finally you can see that. So this you can see a top level view of classifications of the point cloud at some level. As you can see, the three-dimensional view of the very same point cloud classified. All those blue, etc., are actually support sticks in the plant. So you would always find a lot of infrastructure, which are a lot of hindrances for classification. And these are the classified outputs wherein each plant is identified. And of course, it's also a function of nitrogen. But at this level of classification, we could not find a discrimination of plants with nitrogen in the classification level. So that is one limitation that we have found with this only using point cloud data. And you can see when we compare the results with the very same original point architecture and another model of this graph-based CNN, you find that the accuracy is something about 85%, more or less. Yeah, in the same maximum for one of two classes, but overall you say the plant level classification is at best 65 to 70%. So the lowest, if you look at 65% is the accuracy that you can ascribe, and the highest level you can say 70%. So of course still way forward, but if you look at only the crops, then the discrimination is a little bit better, you can say about 80% like that, but still, you know, it's a way forward. And another thing that we like just like to make is that if you like to have this nutrient level discrimination, in the sense, if you like to have plants or crops differentiated or measured for their various kind of parameters with specific reference to nitrogen or let's say nutrient, in this example we found that using merely 3D point cloud is not actually making it happen. So because the differences could be mainly in the structural, in the spectral domain. So again, you have to come back to the spectral information, such that maybe combination of both these structural parameters from LiDAR and the spectral parameters for multispectral data could be a solution wherein you can have this discrimination done, and also the specific nutrient level is also achieved. So that is one of the example that we try to pursue, and just have like to show a few slides of them before we close. So maybe you can go. Of course, this is the overall methodology that we followed and in arriving at this kind of output. And finally, the classification that we use is a simple random forest view classification, and it is done at the plant level is what you got from the LiDAR, and the pixel is approximated, and finally pixels are now actually pointized, so that you can have a one-to-one correspondence with LiDAR and multispectral data. The reason is that multispectral data is at a different resolution, whereas the point cloud is at different resolution. So somewhere you need to strike a balance such that you will have the baseline data measured. So once you segment and finally combine the features at the feature level, and if you like to have these crops classified at the object level. So here is a true object level, where in the raster level object level, then you would have got crop maps, in the sense various crop maps in this case, vegetable crop string, and with specific reference to nitrogen as well. So this is the thing, wherein different colors indicate different levels of nutrient treatment, and for all the three crops involved. So if you see that, the combination is very much distinct, in which you can find that crops are discriminated. At the same time, the discrimination is even very much appreciative when you look at even the specific reference to nitrogen as well. So nutrient condition. So it indicates that you would find much more importance of both spectral and geometrical features if you like to have a practical remote sensing application of a precision crop. Yeah, so it is the same worldview 3 classification if you just ignore the kind of thing. And the summary, just can you go one slide before? Yes, so as you can see, the combination of data, worldview in the sense image only or LiDAR only, and a combination, if you look at that, at some level of discrimination, if you say that I'm not interested in nutrient specificness, then you can use either, say, a point cloud or even high resolution multispectral data will do that kind of discrimination. But if you like to have this nutrient specific or any attribute specific discrimination, then a combination is the solution that is evident from these results. Yeah, so just to summarize, what actually happens is that remote sensing has been very successful at regional to, you would say, national level or even global level at some level, at some point of time. But most important attribute for any precision farming at a farmer level adaptation is the structure, plant structure, and which is a combination of geometrical features is very important for any practical remote sensing of agriculture. And we have found that this even ground-based laser scanner are also one of the sources of this thing. And most important thing, the quality, the timeliness, and the repeatability of this technique is very much by methods that you use, and most important, computing power. So it is enormous. As of now, the demand is very enormous, and processing several millions of points is a big problem, particularly when you like to do on a large scale. So these are some of the things, both potential and as well as bottlenecks of these three-dimensional point cloud application to specific, you know, agriculture. So thank you. The next slide. So thank you. So that's about the thing. And we like to have a small demo of these point cloud classification, if you like. Is that fine, Dr. Sharam?
Yeah, just go ahead, sir, quickly.
Yeah, so we'll have to wrap up by 11 o'clock, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, fine. Thank you. So, Reggie, could you please start the demo?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Good morning, everybody. Myself is Reggie. I am a PhD scholar at IAST under the guidance of Ramarao, sir. So, as sir has already told how the processing of the point cloud data is being done. So, my PhD topic is 3D LiDAR point cloud processing using statistical and machine learning methods in precision agriculture. So, this is the data that we collected. And this is a three-dimensional view of the data. So here, as shown in that experimental setup and in the data capture, a number of scans were taken, and finally they were all registered together. And this is the overall crop. Like this many plots were there, and it has been registered to form one single file. So basically the format of this structure that we get is the standardized one, that is in .las or .laz format. If we look closely at the data, then we can see, so these are not images like what we see in the typical spectral imagery kind of thing. This is a 3D data, and these are the three different kinds of crops. So this one is the first one is the tomato. This is the eggplant, then the middle one is a tomato, and the third one is the cabbage. So before being fed into a deep learning architecture, we have to do some initial pre-processing task, like the data that we get from as input from the scanner will be having the height above mean sea level ground. So we have to do tasks such as the ground filtering to remove the ground and the non-ground points. The ground points corresponds to the soil that is present. So here we can see, so this is the data that has been processed data. Post-processed data is the one. But even here, we can see that in the case of this middle one, this tomato crop, even though we have done the filtration process, we can see that a lot of this brown color, which is the soil particles, which we were not able to separated due to the fact that when we in this agriculture field there are lot of furrows and ridges that is present. So when we tend to remove this, then there is a high chance that the plant points will also be removed. And if we look closely at this, and if we want to select one point and see what is the information that is present in this. So here, if I click at this particular point, so this particular point is in the local coordinate system that is showing the 39 x, y, and z. And this is a normalized one. So the height there is 0.5 in meters. And then also it has the associated red, green, and blue colors. So right now, this is not a classified data. This is an unclassified data, which has to be fed into a classifier. So from this point, after doing this, then what we have to do is that we have to segment each of the crops. And the classes that we have considered here is the three crops, the three important agriculture, horticulture crops that is being used in India. So those are, along with that, then since the soil is also present, we have to remove the soil as well as this is an irrigated experimental setup. So it has this white color that we can see along with this cabbage as a pipe structure. So that also has to be removed. So this led to having five classes being included in that. And then we have to manually segment. So we were working at a individual plant level. So for that, we have to manually segment the crops at a plant level. So after doing this manual segmentation, you can see that here we have different folders, which has this cabbage, eggplant, tomato, etc. all segmented, and it is saved in the text format. So if we take a look at this, then for example, if we try to open this in a Cloud Compare software, this is how it looks like, one individual cabbage crop. So like that, we have segmented all the cabbage crops like this. Then also we have this soil, stick, and pipe along with that. So in order to give this to the deep learning architecture, we have divided it into different plots. So each plot will be having like cabbage, then the pipe, then the soil that is present, and tomato if it is that is there, then that. So like that, it has been segmented as different plots. So these different plots, then that will be combined. And then what we have done is that this all will be combined and it will be represented in an HDFI format. So while doing that, we are not considering all the points because this contains millions of points. So we are not considering all these millions of points there. So while selecting the points for the classification purpose, we are selecting some points and randomly discarding some points so that the size of the data decreases considerably. And also while I showed here that when we are like when we click on an individual point, you can see that this XG, YG, ZG. So these points, you can see that the coordinates are in UTM. So you can see that how big or how large the coordinates are. So these are kind of like global coordinates. So we have to reduce the size of the file, means processing this day while we give this as an input to a deep learning architecture. It itself is a powerful and also time consuming architecture for it to run. So we will reduce this to something like what we see here at the left side, like 36.86 by subtracting from the maximum number. And then it will be given as an input. So this will be given in a format known as HDFI format. So HDFI format can handle large data as such. So this data, so what essentially that HDFI format will consist of is that X, Y, Z coordinates along with the RGB. RGB values we get from the TLS sensor itself because it takes the photos along while the scanning is in progress. So we get that RGB data, and then since we have segmented it, we will have the classes associated with that. So the classes will also be associated with that. So that will be given as the input. Then here, so this is so the number of points we take is we have considered for each plot, we have considered 6 to 4096 points. and then we are giving this input. So here we are generating the HDFI format and then saving that. So this format then goes to the input. So earlier when people started working with this deep learning architecture, they were finding it difficult actually to give the directly the TLS point cloud data to the architecture. So but this when this method came, it was easier because they are doing directly ingesting this data as such as points itself to the architecture. Earlier they were doing it like they were converting that to image representation, and then how we do in the spectral data or a typical microvision images like that they were doing it earlier. So then after that, after the generation of the H5 data, then we will be calling this training. So training, we will call this training, and then there will be a log file that will be associated with this. So for this deep learning, we have used, as I told, it is a 2D CNN architecture, and the library that we have used for the deep learning is the TensorFlow library 1.10 when we are using at that time. So then for that, after running that, there will be a log file that will be created. So in that log file, if you look at this, you can see here that here we can see the model.ckpt. So this is a model that is being created after training, which will be having all the weights and biases in that. So when we are saving this model after running, we have ran to 30 epochs. So this is the log file that tells how the training has been done. So here the accuracy that we get during training is for the 30th epoch, we got is the 98 for the training, and the validating it that we got up to 85. Okay, so then so this is the model. Now after training the model, what we have to do is that we have to keep a text batch for this. So one plot that I have shown here, any one of this like plot 1, 2, 3, which consists of different classes here. So we can reserve one for testing purpose. So this one will be given us, any one of this will be given us the testing, and the rest will be given for training. And for testing, we use this batch inference program. So here the input is being given, and the input that is given is this is the input that is being given. So here it is Python batch inferences, and so many input parameters can also be given here. So we can see that at the beginning of this program there is an argparse. So here we have to, while we are putting this in the command line, we have to give that, of course, we have to use a GPU to run this deep learning architecture. So which GPU, if the system has more than one GPU, we can allocate a particular GPU to that. Then the batches, in how many batches, as you know, for the deep learning, we will be given it in a small batches for training purpose. So also in the testing also we can do like that. And the number of points that is being selected, we can even increase the number of points. So default is being set to 4096, and where the model path corresponds to where the model is being saved. So that I have showed you in the log file, the model.ckpt checkpoint that is being saved. So that model path we have to specify, and then where the output has to be given. So that is the dump dir. So that is a kind of that inside the log file, there will be a dump folder where the final output will be saved. So this is a command line that is there, and this we can give us input. This we can give to the like this, we have to give here and then press the enter key. So press the enter key. So then that path has to be set, obviously. Then only we can run that. Then after running, so in the log file, it will take some 10 to 15 minutes to run that. So after running, then we will get in the dump is a folder that is being created. So here we will get this as an output. So here actually the output that we get is in two text formats. Like one will be the ground truth that we will provide as an input, and then the other one is the predicted one. So these are the two. So here we have combined it together, and we can see how that turns. So this is one software named Fugro Viewer, where we can just view the data. So this the available last file field here, the import feed, we have X, Y, Z already. So we have here additional fields. Since this is in text data, we have to tell what all inputs that we are giving to this one. So RGB is there. Then there are one is the prediction. The next value is the attribute is a prediction one. So that we will give us classification. And next, we don't have an option again to give classification, so that I'm just giving that it as return number. So simultaneously, we will see it in Cloud Compare also. Cloud Compare opens quickly. So we can see that here, these are the X, Y, Z coordinates, then the RGB values, and these are the classifications. So this is the original, this is the classified one, and this is the original one. So this is how the classified data looks like. So if you click at a corresponding point, then we can see that what classes is. So two corresponds to the cabbage. Then this is the tomato. So the yellow that we see here are the soil particles. Then if we look at here, see, we can see that this is one stick over here. So that the sticks are planted there for giving support to the tomato plants. So here we can see that this misclassification of this stick as a crop itself. So those were the real challenges that we faced, like the soil and the sticks were causing a real problem to the tomato crops. So we have seen that for the class in the classification also. The classification accuracy has drastically reduced for this tomato crop. So here we can see a more clear you get a more clear picture of how the classification has been carried out. Okay, so that is how this is being done. Thank you. If anybody have any questions, then you can ask.
Thank you, Reji, for delivering the session, demonstrating. And thank you, Rama Rao, sir.
Thank you.
For a wonderful presentation.